It was intended to be sung, and so it's commended to the director of music, and there is a tune, a musical term that's given so people could use this in their worship many thousands of years ago. And it begins, "Help, Lord, for the godly are no more. The faithful have vanished from among men. Everyone lies to his neighbor. Their flattering lips speak with deception." And then in the middle of verse 5, God does something about all that lying and all that deceit. "I will now arise, says the Lord. I will protect them from those who malign them. And the words of the Lord are flawless, like silver refined in a furnace of clay, purified 7 times. So tonight we're thinking about fake news, very topical, and about God's news, God's truth, God's word, fake news, and God's flawless words, his perfect, pure, well-refined word of truth. I want us to notice 3 things tonight as we look at Psalm 12. And the first is simply that people lie. There is such a thing out there as fake news. Psalm 12 is relevant. We may not list this among one of our favorite psalms. It might not be the kind of thing that we would ask for if we were going to be on a Christian version of Desert Island Discs. Give us your favorite Christian songs of all time. I don't think this one's going to be up there with "When I Survey the Wondrous Cross." And yet, isn't it amazing when you open the Word of God and you read the songs and the prayers of the Bible and you think about them, how they make sense? The way to benefit from a psalm especially is not just to read it and think, okay, wet my finger, next one, next one. You've got to let these things shape you and shape your thinking and your praying by letting a song, a prayer in the Bible get into you, wash over your soul. You've got to meditate on it. The first psalm tells us to do that. Blessed is the one, blessed is the man who does this, who meditates in the law of the Lord and delights in it. So what happens when you meditate on a part of the Word of God like this is that you start to see how to listen to the voices around you, maybe in your family, maybe in your workplace where it's quite difficult being a Christian, maybe in your school, in your uni, in your college. It can be really difficult to live for Jesus Christ. And people can tease you, they can mock you if you are a distinctively Christian person in your thoughts and in your lifestyle. And many people are panicking a bit about where the world is going, where Scotland is going, where those who pass laws and those who run industry and those who run the various things that shape our culture are going. The BBC, can you trust them? People who make records and music, can you trust the shapers of culture, the people who make films and television programs? Can you trust their values and their worldview? And these problems are not just out there in society, they're inside the broader Christian church as well. There's a huge amount of caving in to the values around us in much of what calls itself Christianity today. Are you worried where Christianity will be in 30, 40, 50 years from now in Scotland or indeed in Western Europe? Are you worried about the cause of the gospel in the town or the village where you live? Maybe there was a vibrant Christian church there 50 years ago, and maybe there's next to nothing where you live now. I had the privilege of knowing the late Alistair Ross. He was a lovely, godly man a wonderful teacher of God's word, very easy to listen to as a preacher. And he began his ministry here in Rosshire about 60 years ago up in Strathpeffer. And he told me once that between members and adherents, there were about 400 names on his call to be minister at Strathpeffer. I don't know if you could get 400 names on a call if you put together the churches from Rosine all the way to Inverness and asked all the active Christians and all the people to turn up at church from Mid Ross, from the Black Isle, from Easter Ross, will you put your name to calling a pastor? I don't know if in 2017 you would get 400 names. But 50 plus years ago, one village in the Highlands had that many adherents and members who were interested enough to say, yes, I want that man to be my pastor. And does make us ask, well, what happened? What happened to Scotland? What happened to the Highlands? What happened to the church? Did we do something wrong? Were there forces out there that were irresistible? And I think this psalm is actually very helpful because it reminds us that we must not listen to the lies people tell. And we must not listen to the lies of Satan. We must not listen to the lies that are peddled by the culture. We must listen to God. What verse 1 and verse 2 of this psalm make very clear is that we need to be alert and careful to the messages that we take in and believe. So be careful what you read. Be careful what you believe. Be careful if you use something like social media. Be careful what you share. And be careful that your words are true, that what you say is the gospel truth. Be careful, because people deceive, people lie. I'm going to show you a couple of pictures just to keep our interest. Now, you can see a copy of Private Eye from a few years ago, quite a few years ago, maybe around the time the coalition government came in, the world's first face transplant, a success. And you see Tony Blair's face being put onto David Cameron. I quite like that one. Private Eye is actually in 2017, you may find this hard to believe, but Private Eye is the best-selling news and current affairs magazine in the United Kingdom. Did you know that? Well, that Wikipedia says it, so it must be true. I was shocked to read that, but more than, I don't know, Newsweek or a newspaper, it sells more copies than the newspapers and the magazines. So it's not Spectator or The Economist or whatever that you need to worry about. Private Eye is where it is. And of course, Private Eye is full of satire and humour and mocking and having a go at society and the church and people in leadership, politicians especially. We are in the age of what people call fake news. So it's okay to have satire. Maybe if you're around in the 80s, you remember Spitting Image, and they used to have wonderful caricatures of people like Margaret Thatcher. If you've got a longer memory than me, you may go back even to remember that was the week that was. Do any of you remember that? That was the week. Yeah, there's a few. Alan is very much older than me. He's wearing pretty well, really. I can remember quite a lot of satire on radio and TV. Some that are still on the go are the BBC's Have I Got News For You? Maybe some of you watch that. Or the news quiz on the radio. Maybe some of you enjoy things like that. And there's always been a history of cartooning. So there have always been people who had a go through cartoons, Punch in the 19th century, and the newspapers' cartoons in the 20th and 21st centuries, having a go at humour. I don't have a problem with satire or with humour. That can actually be really helpful to just cut through a lot of nonsense. But fake news is different from satire. Fake news is just what people call lying. Fake news is trying to manipulate and deceive people. So you will get headlines, maybe if you use Facebook or Twitter or something like that, you will get things that are called clickbait that will make you follow something. And often the more lurid or the more amazing or the more crazy the allegation, the more people will be tempted to believe it or to follow it or to share it. And this is a problem because it is widely understood that there are forces at work in the world, including Islamist fascists, people like ISIS and the Taliban, who will use social media to spread their poison and to undermine peace and democracy in various parts of the world, in the Arab world and in the Western nations as well. There's a general election taking place, the first part of the election for the presidency in France today, and they'll whittle down their candidates from, I think, 15 to 2, and then they'll have a final runoff election, I think, next week. And apparently there are 30,000 fake Facebook accounts in France. 30,000 pumping out stories, praising one candidate, pushing down another candidate, trying to affect the outcome of the election. Everyone says it's going to be a close election. It could be a fascist or it could be an extreme communist who ends up being among the two in the runoff. It could be people from both extremes in the runoff. That could be seriously destabilizing for one of the largest countries in Europe. And maybe the balance of that election is in the hands of people who spread lies, fake news. The story on the screen, I'm sure you can't maybe make it out, but it's one that was shared last November, just before the American election. It's a headline from the Denver Guardian, which says that an FBI agent suspected in Hillary email leaks found dead in apartment murder suicide. Great. So if you're going to vote Trump, you share this. And this story was shared 100 times a minute at its peak. Only problem is there is no newspaper called the Denver Guardian, and there's no truth at all in the story. It's just another thing to make people think, well, there's something funny about that Hillary woman. I don't think I'm going to vote for her. Maybe I'll give my vote to nice Mr. Trump, because he wouldn't kill people and hide the bodies. Now, somebody devious has put that story out, and maybe people with the opposite views did the same. Maybe there were fake stories about Mr. Trump, but there were certainly plenty fake stories encouraging people not to consider his opponent. And some people have fingered the Russian government for being behind some of this. Is it possible that Mr. Putin chose who would win the American election of 2016? Is it possible? Well, if it's not fake news, you heard it here first. Well, you probably heard it in every other newspaper in the country as well. We have a problem with fake news. It used to be called spin, and the spin doctors would try and get their message across. But spinning something that's sort of true is maybe understandable, but it seems we're now in an age where truth doesn't matter. Post-truth. Just try to get people to believe the lie. Make the lie close enough to reality that enough people will believe it. It's disastrous. Where people don't trust newspapers, they don't trust the BBC, they don't trust Sky, they don't trust any source for their news on the mainstream media, and they're not sure what they can trust on the internet either, because people lie. Well, this should not surprise us. The psalm says here, "Help, Lord, for the godly are no more. The faithful have vanished." It looks like the church is done and finished. It looks like believers and the righteous, those who love God and his truth, are finished. Everyone lies to his neighbor. Their flattering lips speak with deception. People are out to deceive. Dale Ralph Davis, in his commentary on this psalm, encourages people to be a covenant man or a covenant woman. If you love the truth of God, if you love the word of God, let it shape you. God is faithful. Be faithful. Let the faithful word shape you to be a covenantal, truth-telling, truth-loving person. Not led away by the spin doctors of unbelief and of malice. And the commentator Derek Kidner, in his book on the Psalms, he warns about empty talk in verse 2. Everyone lies to his neighbors. And Kidner points out that that word for lies, that the basic meaning of the Hebrew word there is more accurately emptiness. It's empty talk. It's got no content. It's got no validity. It's got no meaning. It includes falsehood, direct lying, but it's also talking about insincerity and irresponsible talk that cheapens and corrodes human contact and relationships. Well, that's the 21st century. Who knows what you can believe in advertising? If you want to go onto a price comparison website, read the small print. Because the first half dozen special offers that they give you, they have often been paid to give you, and they're not the best offers. If you read the small print or if you click the right box, you may suddenly discover that actually this brilliant deal is maybe the seventh or the eighth best deal that they've got to offer you. But they've been paid by some big company to offer their deal first. That's the age that we're living in. People lie. But you can be a covenant woman. You can be a covenant man. By the grace of God, you can love truth and not have an empty life of, oh, let's share this on Twitter. Let's share this on Facebook. I don't know if it's true. I won't take 2 seconds to find out if it's true. I'll just share it anyway. People lie. Don't go along with a culture of lies. But the second thing I want us to think about is that people boast against God. And you've got this in the middle of the psalm. Verse 3 and 4, "May the Lord cut off all flattering lips and every boastful tongue that says, 'We will triumph with our tongues.' We own our lips, do we? Who is our master? Let's push God away. Let's make up our own truth. Let's decide what's true and what's not true. Let's redefine terms like marriage. Let's say that there's no such thing as a given gender. Let's say we can choose our gender. Let's say that there's no such thing as fixed sexuality, that it's fluid. Let's say that there's no such thing as right and wrong or even shades of gray. It's just what's true for you and what truth do you want?" I gave the example this morning of the scout promise, the oath that the scouts take, and the guides, of course, a few years ago changed it to, "I promise to believe in myself and do my duty to myself." Very 21st century. You must believe in yourself. Well, what if you're wrong? It's the only standard by which we should measure ourselves and our beliefs, what feels good right now in this moment. There are still people alive who remember when it felt good to persecute the Jews of Europe. There are people alive who remember when it felt good to verbally assault people from the Caribbean who'd come across in the 50s and 60s to live in the United Kingdom. No Irish, no blacks. felt good. These are our values. Don't like black people. Let's be nasty to them. Well, I think we would all agree in this room tonight, that's wrong. But how do we know? How do we know what's right, what's wrong? There is an anti-God conspiracy. It began in the garden when the devil, the father of lies, told the first lie to Adam and Eve, "You shall not surely die." You can ignore God, you can push God away, and there are no nasty consequences. That's a lie. But those who live their lives without God and want to boast about it keep repeating that lie. And that's what the middle of this psalm is saying. Flattering lips, boastful tongues. We can make up our own truth. We own our lips. We own our thoughts. I am my own master. Doesn't work. Or verse 8, the wicked freely strut about when what is vile, what is dirty, what is evil is honored among men. Now that might be get-rich-quick schemes that abuse people, that steal from the gullible or the vulnerable, or it might be the kind of disgusting exploitation that was reported last week. Apparently it is legal, and it happens in this country, that people who own property will advertise, they'll go on to Gumtree, they'll go on to Craigslist, and they'll say, if you are homeless, you can share my flat as long as I can have sex with you 3 times a week. And apparently that's lawful, breaks no law in the United Kingdom. Well, it's wrong, and it breaks the law of God clearly. And there's something really sad and really mad about a culture that needs more than half a second to work out that that's slavery and that that's abuse and that's taking advantage of the vulnerable and the needy and the young and the poor. It's just wrong to treat people like property who can be ripped off and used. It's wicked. But here, the psalmist, he got here 3,000 years ago, the wicked freely strut about when what is vile is honored among men, boasting by honoring what God hates. This seems to be the way secularism goes in our age, in our culture, that says, God is dead, we are beyond challenge, we say what goes. We are our own gods. We have won. Christianity is dead. The Bible is dead. That is so yesterday. And so our parliament, a few days ago, without a vote, in Scotland, debated what they call Time for Inclusive Education, which has been using the press and lobbying MPs for months and for years to re-educate children in primary schools, that they can choose their own gender, that all flavors of sexuality are equally healthy and valuable. Now, I don't mind our schools teaching boys and girls good health messages and about respect and about using loving and respectful language of each other, but I think that explicit teaching about all kinds of bizarre sexualities for primary school children is a form of sex abuse of the minds and bodies of children. And it is disgusting that state money is being used so that extremists in the LGBT community, extremists with extreme views, are using state funding to lobby the state to change the law so that teachers cannot decide what they teach in their own classrooms and are forced to be re-educated by the state to indoctrinate children. It's an experiment on the future that is wrong. And I read the debate carefully from our Scottish Parliament last Tuesday or Wednesday. I could only spot one Christian who got up and spoke in that debate who said nothing critical about Time for Inclusive Education. and most either weren't called or didn't speak. Everyone who spoke was in agreement. Everyone who spoke was in agreement with a sort of stonewall agenda. Now, I think we need to love men and women who are homosexual and embrace them. And I think I said loud and clear this morning, the doors of this church are open and our homes are open and our hearts are open for everyone in our community. And the gospel is for everyone in our community. But there are bodies in our society, and what they do is they freely strut about when what is vile is honored among men. They love what is unhelpful and unhealthy and dangerous for human beings. Why is it that the suicide rate and that other diseases are claiming the lives of so many people involved in particular sexual lifestyles, risky behavior? People are dying 20 years, 30 years before they should. And everybody zips their lips and says, we cannot talk about that. That's to be anti-LGBTI. Let's dishonor what God says, and let's boast about it. Let's love what God warns us about. Let's hate what God loves. Well, we're in trouble if we don't go along with this bandwagon, but maybe it's no bad thing to be in trouble and to realize that secularism is not neutral, and that those who wish to put Christianity into a private box where it's just an hour or two of your life, but it doesn't go into the workplace. If you're a teacher, if you're a medic, if you're a nurse, if you're a social worker, you leave your Christianity, you leave your Christian values at home because you've got to go along with a secular, multi-flavor view of things. I'll give you a little quote from Shami Chakrabarty. She's not someone I tend to quote from all too often, but she was for a time involved in being the director of Liberty. But she said a few years ago, about 6-7 years ago, that the law is bending over backwards for Muslims and Sikhs while Christians are being persecuted with impunity. I haven't heard a politician in the House of Lords or in the House of Commons or in the Scottish Parliament say what is blatantly the case, that Christians can lose their jobs, lose their careers, lose their promotion for being Christians, but it wouldn't happen to a Muslim, it wouldn't happen to a Sikh. Thank you, Shami Chakrabarty, for saying what is true. Wouldn't it be nice if the whole of society woke up and acknowledged this? Don't expect the BBC or ITV or Sky or the Hollywood films to be neutral. They are offering you a view of the world, which is the view of the people who produced the film, the news reporter, whatever. And if it's anti-God or if it's anti the values of the Bible, you need to make up your mind. Will you immerse your mind in the truth of God, or will you just allow the wave after wave after wave of the people who boast against God, will you let it wear you down until you go along with it? People lie. People take their stand and they boast against God. But the last thing, verse 5, 6, and 7, God's word is flawless. It's still flawless. Verse 5 says, because of the oppression of the weak and the groaning of the needy, I will now arise, says the Lord. God is going to get up and do something about what's clearly wrong. I will protect them from those who malign them, use words against them. And the words of the Lord, verse 6, are flawless. Imagine you've melted silver to clean off all the impurities from the mining process, and you've heated up the silver until it's molten, and you can look at your face being reflected on the surface of the metal, all the impurities are gone. It is perfect, it is pure, it is flawless. It has been tested and refined in the furnace. The words of the Lord are flawless. The gospel of God, the truth of God is flawless. We live in a brave new world, but remember, there is no slag, no rubbish, no dross, no impurity in Christ and in his word. It is pure silver, it is pure gold. Think of Psalm 119, meditating on the word of God. Sweeter than honey, more precious than gold, the word of God. Now, I don't know what's going to happen in our culture or in the church in the next 5 years, let alone the next 50. But I know that the God who said to David in Psalm 12, write, I will arise, I will get up, I will deal with what's wrong, I will deal with the lies, I will deal with the fake news, I will deal with the people who mock God and his truth, I will deal with it. That God who spoke to David 3,000 years ago, he keeps intervening. He might not intervene in Scotland in the next 5 years, but he might. He might not intervene in the next 10, but he might. But I know that God will arise, and that the flawless character and nature of God and the truthfulness of his word will be seen. If not before, it will be seen when God chooses, or at the judgment. God said in Psalm 46 that he will be exalted among the nations. Doesn't look like that right now in Western Europe, but he will be. God promised his son, the Messiah, that all generations would remember him and praise his name. Think of Psalm 72, his name forever shall endure. So God will get up, God will arise, and God will speak. I'll give you an example. You may know Don Carson, who's taught and helped so many to understand the Bible. He teaches in Chicago in Illinois. But he came from Canada. Don is short for Donald. So there is a Donald in America who is thoroughly reliable. And if Don Carson tweets, you can follow the real Don Carson, even if you don't follow the real Donald Trump. This Donald is worth listening to. And Donald Carson wrote a book about his father. And his father was called Tom Carson, and he was a pastor who was a missionary in Quebec, in Canada, to the French-speaking people of Quebec, who were very traditional Roman Catholic, very opposed to evangelicalism, very opposed to Bible churches. And he was there in the 1940s and the 1950s when it was really difficult, a real slog, and when only a handful of people believed in the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. And when hundreds, thousands were terribly resistant, persecuted those missionaries who were working in Quebec at that time. But Tom Carson's life story was written up by his son, and in it he talks about some of the difficulties, the hard going. Here's a quote. Most of the French works in Quebec at this time were stalled. We're talking the 1950s. A strong work, a really strong church, might climb to 30 or 40 people, but usually did not stay there very long. Almost 10 years would pass before there was a dramatic improvement. This was still slogging work in a fairly hostile environment. Tom Carson was tempted to give up, tempted to despair, tempted to leave the ministry among the Quebecois. But he kept going, and others after him kept going. And in the decade of the 1970s, suddenly in Quebec, there was an explosion of evangelical work among the French-speaking Canadians. And from about 40 gospel churches, the work grew to around 400 to 500 churches in a decade. an incredible growth from 40 to 400-500 churches and preaching points in one decade. Some people faithfully sharing the flawless word of God for 20, 30, 40 years, seeing very little. And then God arises and works. I have a vision for this church. I have no problem seeing this church doubling and more than doubling in a short time. I have a vision for gospel churches in the Highlands and throughout our land. I have a vision for the denomination. I'm not hugely bothered about denominations. They're just vehicles. But, you know, the Free Church, it's had its ups and its downs. But it seems to me, if you've looked at the pretty depressing church census that was recently published, there was a census taken on the whole Scottish church last year, and it's a story of nosediving decline among traditional churches that don't really take the Bible very seriously. They're just dying. They're falling off a cliff. That kind of Christianity has halved in Scotland in the last 20 years. But churches that love the Bible and teach the Bible are either holding their own or growing. So why can't the Free Church double, treble, quadruple in the next 10, 20 years and have gospel churches full of life, full of people meeting Jesus? Now, I don't care what the label over the door is, and I would love it if gospel people came together. Maybe it's time for a whole new denomination that really loves the Bible and the Word of God. Maybe sometimes the old wineskins have to be tossed aside and a new wine goes in a new wineskin. So I'm not going to be depressed about the Free Church. But I am excited about the prospects of Bible-believing Word of God churches, because what they have is the flawless Word of God. People lie. People boast against God. But God's word is purer than refined silver, purer than refined gold. And as the Canadian Quebec church discovered, in his time, his flawless word will prevail. When God decides, I will arise, everything changes. Just notice who is speaking in verse 5. Because of the oppression of the weak and the groaning of the needy. This is the first person singular. I will now arise. I will protect those who are being mocked and slandered. I will protect those who are being maligned. The words of the Lord are flawless. Who said a change will come? Who said righteousness will come? Who said covenant man and covenant woman will be protected? Who said it? God said it. I will do it. Not David. God said, I will arise. God, show us when we are being lied to. Show us when the news is fake news. Show us when Satan, the father of lies, is manipulating even the church. Show us your gospel truth, your unchanging truth. We thank you for the 40th chapter of Isaiah and for the vision of the sovereign God who comforts his people. Comfort, comfort my people, says your God. And in the midst of all of that, he promises, though we are frail, though our lives are brief, though our life should fade away like a flower, your word is everlasting. Your word is eternal. We pray, Lord, that we will embrace your flawless word, that we will bury it in our hearts, teach it to our children, and share it with our neighbors and our communities. Bless to us this psalm that we've read tonight, and may it come back to us in the next few days. If we use the internet, may we be careful what we read, careful what we share, careful what we believe, but then may we come away from it and open your word, your flawless word, and believe everything we read. we ask through Christ our Lord. Amen.